because you want them to love you back. Love is not like that. Martin knew that. Malcolm was the same way. What was the percentage of black people who approved of Malcolm when he was alive? It was very small. But the love was undeniable. The same with true with the early Huey. Now the later Huey, a little different, isn't it? He's almost like Tupac. He had that freedom orientation and that thuggish orientation going on at the same time, like all of us, I guess. But I'm saying that because I think that we need a spiritual and a moral awakening. We need a whole new generation of folk saying, you know what? We love Jamal and Letitia. They're as precious as anybody else in the world, and we're going to go down swinging to convince the world that if you don't believe it, we do, and you can kill us if you want to. That's what we need.
And then we go into the laboratory and do our medical work. Then we're going back to the library and write our poems. That's Sonja Sanchez. That's Gwendolyn Brooks. Then we're going back to the second floor of the house of Dix Hills and write Love Supreme. You know, they got a picture of John Coltrane on the third row, Malcolm speaking at the militant forum. All of his agents said, stay away from Malcolm, John. Stay away from Malcolm Train. I said, hey. Free black man. I want to see what he got to say. And they interviewed him after. Train, what you got to say about Malcolm?
Highly impressive. Full of so much love.
Love, he's the hate that produced hate.
They lying on him. Don't believe the hype.
You see what I mean?
And now we see that today, even with this Fox News scandal. Well, there's always a Fox News scandal, right? The latest one being the miscategorization of Black Lives Matter as a hate group.
Absolutely.
When in fact, Black Lives Matter is a love group, right? That is actually formed out of a deep and abiding love for black people. And so it reinscribes this Malcolmian history of being of critiques of violence being reconstructed as violence, critiques of racism being reconstructed as racism. And so there's that piece. I want to talk to you, Dr. West, about this phrase, Black Lives Matter.
Mm.
You know, one of the things you talk about over your entire corpus of work, as rich and masterful as it is the vocation of the intellectual, the insurgent intellectual, and it being about a commitment to truth-telling, a commitment to allowing suffering to speak, and also helping to guide us and be precise with the language that we use and make sure that it's historically precise. And so the phrase Black Lives Matter for me, and I was saying this before, has always been somewhat problematic to me. Problematic is probably not the best word, but it's the only word I have at my disposal right now, in the sense that while I support and uplift the labor that went into producing Black Lives Matter as a hashtag in 2013 by those three sisters, Alicia Garza, Patrice Cullors, and Opal Tometi, the phrase seems a little bit imprecise in that the American Empire doesn't seem to have ever had a problem agreeing or affirming that Black Lives Matter, that we live in a nation where black bodies are this country's original currency, and that this nation is therefore thus founded on the literal mattering of black people. And that even today, when you think about the privatization of prisons, these folks who are privatizing prisons know that black lives matter, because without those black lives, we couldn't fill those prison cells. And so racism itself could not exist. Racism only exists because black lives matter. Racism exists and depends on black lives matter. So it's not a question of whether or not black lives matter.
Yeah.
It's a question of whether black lives are human. That the very idea that black people are human is a relatively new concept in the history of Western ideas, that it's a modern concept. So I'm wondering, my question is, how are we, our unwillingness or our lack of our dishonesty in dealing with that legacy is really part of the problem. That it's not really a question of us mattering, though of course we do, but it's a question of how do we deal with the legacy of still not being considered human.
Well, that's the core of white supremacy. That's so deep, but I do agree with your analysis in terms of the fact that it's black people's labor that produced the wealth foundation. My brother Trump, he said, the people who built this country, please, Donna, your mama's from Scotland. So you've only been here. Your grandfather's from Germany. So we glad you're here, but you just got here. We've been here 9 generations. We built it a zillion times more than you built it. that sense, black bodies, black labor, black control of black, white control of black people on land stolen from indigenous peoples does acknowledge that black lives matter. But part of it is to say, well, we're saying that black lives matter to us, not just to your profit margin. Black lives matter to who we are as human beings, not just to your trigger happy police. See what I mean? It's to whom does it matter? See, my grandmama mattered because she raised your kids. But she matters to me as a child of God. She matters to me as a precious human being. So it's the context of the mattering. And that opens up the dialogue that needs to be to take place, which is to try to, again, tell the fallible truths about the historical emergence, the genealogical sustenance of white supremacy in its various forms. Why is it so resilient? Looked like white supremacist slavery. We broke the back of it in the 1860s. Here comes slavery by another name, as Brother Douglas Blackman. Vanilla Brother wrote that. We let me Blackman, that's interesting. Vanilla Brother, he's telling the truth. This is slavery by another name. This is more torture. This is convict leasing. This is tenant farming. This is sharecropping. Still no control over labor or land. Nothing but a form of terror. And slavery all over again, even though, you know, the 13th Amendment had that one exception. So I hear what you're saying, but your powerful story, your powerful analysis would be part of the dialogue, that particular hashtag. And I think we do have to make a distinction. I know Brother Tim, Poe, and Tori, and Nick, and others have proper concerns that we can't confuse Black Lives Matter with the whole black freedom movement that's come out of Ferguson. See, it is a powerful hashtag. It's a highly creative network. There's some wonderful and creative persons who are connected to Black Lives Matter. But the Ferguson movement was much more on the ground. A number of the people who have been to jail 5 and 10 and 15 times, not even considered part of Black Lives Matter anymore. See, so we have to be very careful about that. Black Lives Matter is still part and parcel of the overall movement. But it's not the core or the essence, or somehow it ought not to take a lot of the oxygen out of the room.
That's right.
Before we allow these other voices and other persons in place at the fundamental role. Because we saw this in the 60s. We had over 125 rebellions, April 5th, 1968. Finally, the oligarch and plutocratic elite says, I think we got a race problem, which means really the threat is real.
Right.
Disorder is coming. Mm-hmm. You can't reproduce capital in disorder. Mm-hmm. You have to have some stability. When there's massive disorder, you got a problem. And to keep in mind, there's no such thing as a Negro problem in the United States. Mm-hmm. There's been catastrophes visited on black people. That's not a problem. You can only confuse the problematic with the catastrophic. You have a catastrophic consciousness because you know you have to deal with all of the features of what catastrophe is. Problem is a way of deodorizing the situation and the conditions. Catastrophe is funky. Psychically, spiritually, socially, politically, and so forth. And in the face of catastrophe, that's why we're blues people. That's what the blues is. Personal narrative of catastrophe, lyrically expressed. Strange fruit. Nobody loves me but my mama. She might be driving too. That's catastrophe. But it's lyrically expressed with such style, and such mastery of craft, and such confidence, and such love, that the despair doesn't have the last word in the face of catastrophe. See that? So in that sense, you say, well, this present day catastrophe, and again, I'm going to stop and open up because I want to learn from this present day catastrophe where, you know, the cultural superficial spectacle that tries to distort every attempt of persons trying to emerge, or groups and organizations trying to emerge. You got to go through the corporate media. We don't have enough alternative media, not enough Amy Goodman, not enough Black Agenda reports and so on. Then you got the politicians who've been so thoroughly colonized and bought off by big money. Very clear. And in that sense, Trump is right. See, Trump's been on the inside for a long time, and he just tells the truth. Oh, I'm sending money to Hillary to make sure she came to the wedding. I'm sending you this money, I want to see you at the wedding. Okay, Don, we're going to have a good time. Hillary, why'd you go? Man, I just went for entertainment. Trump knew what he was doing. He'd give money to everybody. That's how oligarchs operate. The fact he's been doing it for 30 years now, and say all of a sudden he wants to break out of it, just show he ain't got no integrity. He's been doing it all this time. But it's been happening at whose expense? When I was your age, I guess most of y'all about what, 22, 23, 24? When I was your age, 1% of the population owned 21% of the wealth. Today, 1% of the population owned 43% of the wealth. What does that mean? Massive redistribution from poor and working people to 1%. And they say, oh, we're against redistribution. No, you're not against redistribution. When it's upward, you ain't got a mumbling word to say. When it's downward, you call me a communist or a socialist. They call me anything you want. I don't care. That's not the love I got. I don't care what kind of ism you associate with. I don't care what kind of name. I know who I am. I'm my mama's child and daddy's kid. Oh, Jesus loved the free black man. Can't nobody take that away from me. But once you have that, we got to come up with a different set of strategies. Listen, bro. So you ain't lying. Oh, you ain't lying. I was talking on the phone to Sister Valerie. And she was saying, well, after Jay invited me up to the White House, anybody else want to go? I want to go to the White House. I'll be in the crack house. I'll be in the White House. But everybody else, that works for everybody else, but I ain't everybody else. You don't know my mama. I should have met my father. Invite me to no White House and say I can't say what I want to say. Yeah. Eat at McDonald's, God dang it. I mean, I'm serious.
Yeah.
Now, if they want to talk about how you eliminate poverty, I'm going to hitchhike there. I'm going to get there quick. Right. If they're serious. Yeah. You know what I mean? But, and I'm not the only one. I don't want to get this sense of this isolation. There's many, I got so many calls from even, not just black caucus, different black leaders that say, Brother Vance, we with you 120%, but we can't see it. You just keep saying it and catching hell, and we praying for you. I say, I appreciate that division of labor at the moment. That's
right.
That's gonna be forever. Sooner or later, the truth's gonna come forward. You see, and it frees people up. It frees them up. And the same is true with our artists. Mm. It was hard for artists to cut against the grain. Why? They got market calculation. Lupe. Oh, I love that bitch. He just tell the truth. You a terrorist. Dropping those bombs and drones and 231 children. He's absolutely right. Absolutely right. What did they do? They shut down the electricity. DC, when he started singing that, I called him up. He's my Muslim brother. So we'll say a prayer, brother. He's a problem greater than us, because he got some stuff coming at us. I don't know. Now, my prayer's not going to be as lyrically rhythmic as yours. Maybe you want to pray a little bit, too. But our artists, they're back to against the wall. You know, Kanye can talk about Bush not caring for black people. He's absolutely right. I would have liked to see the black Lives Matter movement doing Obama's brain, putting pressure on.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
That's what moral consistency is.
That's right.
It's telling the truth. You're not demonizing the brother. You say, you know what? We notice that the black poor are not a high priority vis-a-vis Wall Street military budget that's been expanded every year in some form. You're privatizing our schools. Thousands of schools were now privatized. Mm-hmm. Let's see, the gentrification still taking place intensely. Let's see, we need to put pressure on you. We need some politics of disruption. Mm-hmm. You can sing Amazing Grace if you want to. Mm-hmm. We don't just want a song. We come and play this saxophone. Put your saxophone down and redo that vicious crime bill you signed and the welfare bill you signed.
and repeating Glass-Steagall. We don't hear your saxophone. We got Coltrane. We hear your saxophone. Well, no, he got a right play of sax. Don't get me wrong. But I'm
And we're about to open up the questions. Yes. But before that, you know, because you mentioned so much that was rich and important, that even when we think of his legacy, how it relates to.
And it's just changing now.
Yeah, because
he's apologizing now.
Yeah, he's apologizing. Then you got the 1033 bill, which is this bill that redistributes military weaponry to police. Congressional Black Caucus report just came out 3 days ago. Overwhelmingly supports the bill.
Yes.
We talking about Jackson Lee, all these supposedly progressive Rangel not voting at all, supporting the bill that sends out military weaponry, literally weapons designed for war, to police officers and to police departments. How do we make sense of that? But I wanted to just before we open up this question of the left, and there's this classic, and you were getting it. There's this classic a bifurcation of the left between those who are saying, fuck the system, we're not gonna vote, the abolitionists essentially, versus the reformists who are often wanting to work in it. And I'm wondering kind of how you think about that, Rick. Another place it shows up is in the question of prisons. You have even Sister Michelle Alexander, who's a reformist, calling for radical reform to the prison industrial complex. Then you got sisters like Angela Davis, Ruthie Gilmore, calling for prison abolition. An undoing of prisons, period. That don't mean just we open up the gates and have folks running out, but it does mean the idea that we're working towards not reform, but abolition. How do you feel about that? Is it useful, that riff? Is it not?
I think it's a good thing. I think people have to be true to who they are. And if Angela and all of her courage and richness and insight decides to be a prison abolitionist, lay out the case, put forward the argument, and you know she's worth listening to. I'm not persuaded, because I know some folks need to put some time on
things. That's what I said.
But,
I know it's,
you still love them, but you know, it raises some things that they need to get a little distance for a while. But you can have rehabilitation. But of course, because, you know, 60% of those in there for non-violent drugs, right. Somehow, the drugs, the offenses are very different than murder,
the violence.
Ugly domestic violence and so forth and so on. But I have great love and respect for Angela. We just did the Oxford Union debate, the 50th anniversary of Malcolm X at Oxford. And we had a great time together. I just wrote an introduction to her latest book. But so that we need different voices. Right. You know, we don't want to suppress the voices. We lift every voice, people. See, we're not into you got to follow me, Pied Piper, my voice is the only important voice. But then you still got to write to your own voice and say, you know what? I haven't thought about it. I'm not convinced. But we can work together, because she knows it's not going to be a ball of soap.